Hi, I'm Colleen Loader, Manager of Sites, Water Materials at the CAGBC. Today's review insight video is my personal favorite, water, and we're focusing on avoiding errors with the indoor water use reduction calculator. For this presentation, we are assuming a basic understanding of the calculator. If you need more explanation to get started, just follow the information on the calculator's instruction tab. We'll jump right in with focusing on the most common pending issues we see with this credit and how to avoid them. If you already know the solution to one of the issues I'm raising, feel free to skip ahead. We have added chapter bookmarks to the video to make it easier to skip ahead or repeat a section. The number one problem we see with the calculator in reviews is with the row that captures the percent of males expected to use restrooms that contain urinals. The calculator defaults to 100%. Assuming that all washrooms that males have access to have urinals. However, if some of your male restrooms do not have urinals, you will need to update this percentage in row 16 to something that matches your layout, like, for example, 50%. If you have almost all washrooms with urinals and say only a couple of universal washrooms without urinals, you can use the 95% default access as per the call instruction boxes. And by the way, these call instruction boxes in the calculator are really helpful. So be sure to read them as you enter your data into the calculator. Issue 2 is with the column percent of occupants. If you scroll down the calculation tab, you will see the flush fixture table and the flow fixture table. The title of this percent of occupants column can be misleading, as one might think my building has half women, half male, that's 50% each. No, in this case, it's percent of occupants of each gender. So since, in my example here, 100% of the females will be using toilet female, we should put 100% for that row here. And the same with toilet male and the urinal. It doesn't matter if your building only has urinals in a quarter of the restrooms. That access to urinal issue is dealt with in the earlier entry I showed you. Here the percents have to equal 100% for each type. The updated instructions are helpful reminders for this. And yes, the calculator assumes male or females. But if your facility has only all gender restrooms, just put 100% under male and female each to estimate. And then be sure to check out the pilot credit for all gender restrooms to achieve an innovation point for your design. Anyway, back to percent of occupants. So where does this feature come in handy? Well, say you have an owner-occupied office and you have a meeting room that's separate from your open office workstations, like shown here. And then say you have a small set of washrooms near the meeting room that have a 4.8 liter flush rate. And you may have another larger set near the workstations with a lower flush rate. How do you account for this? In the calculator, this percent of occupants column allows you to separate your meeting room ones from the workstation ones. And then you can estimate the amount of time the average user will use the workstation ones as compared to the one by the meeting room, shown here as 75%. And 25%. Okay, issue 3. We often see projects that have multiple occupancy types with different access to fixtures. So let's use the example to explain a solution here. Here we have a typical school where the staff have one set of washrooms and the students another. Let's say the staff have 4.8 liter toilets with no urinals, and the students have 4.2 liter toilets and also have urinals. To resolve this, we go to the instruction tab and add another group. This allows us to have different calculation tabs for each user group, staff separately from students. You can then enter the occupancy for each on their own tab, and bonus, you can give different days of operation too, in row 19 to address all those professional development days where the kids are off and the teachers are still working. So now you have separate fixture tables for the students and staff in different tabs, and you can account for the fixtures the students have access to separately from those of the staff. But one caveat with this. When you have more than one user group, so more than one tab, go to the summary tab and remember to refresh the groups. Otherwise, only the first group will be summarized in the percent reduction. Issue 4. Here, let's go over the benefit of the other occupancy column. Basically, other is for when the default uses just don't apply. As you know, LEED assumes a specific number of uses per occupant for varying fixture types, shown here from this table from the calculator. Each user type assumes a specific number of uses, which might not just work for your project. Or for some user types, there may be no assigned usages for a particular fixture. There are many complex occupancies that work well making use of the other column. I've listed a few here, but it's anywhere where the assumptions and daily uses do not work for your particular occupancy groups. Let's look at the first example, dealing with a swimming pool. As we know, for the visitor use type, LEED assigns uses for toilets, urinals, and faucets. There is no use assigned for showers. The visitors normally shower if they're using a public swimming pool, so we need to account for the visitor shower usage. So in the calculator for my community center, I may have three distinct groups: staff, pool users, and gym users. And so I have created three separate user groups. Let's say I have 300 pool users. There are two ways to add them. I can enter them only as other, or since they're using the standard visitor uses as well, I can enter them as visitors too. Either way works. The benefit of adding pool users, both as visitors and others, means I can use the default assumptions for the standard fixtures, rather than having to add them manually to the other column. Less work for me and a greater chance of accuracy. So I'm going to add the uses for the pool users. To estimate the uses you expect, please have the owner weigh in. Providing a narrative on your use assumptions is always helpful in reviews. Now that's a wrap on the top four issues we see with the indoor water use reduction calculator. We do see one more common issue in the water calculator with handling incomplete space. We're going to hold that for another session, focusing just on projects with unfinished space. If you have questions on any of these issues we discussed today, please don't hesitate to reach out to us at LEED Coach Canada. Thank you for listening.